Habit 6. Synergize. Principles of Creative Cooperation. I take as my guide the hope of a saint. In crucial things, unity. In important things, diversity. In all things, generosity. Inaugural Address of President George H.W. Bush. When Sir Winston Churchill was called to head up the war effort for Great Britain, he remarked that all his life had prepared him for this hour. In a similar sense, the exercise of all the other habits prepares us for the habit of synergy. When properly understood, synergy is the highest activity in all life, the true test and manifestation of all of the other habits put together. The highest forms of synergy focus the four unique human endowments, the motive of win-win, and the skills of empathic communication on the toughest challenges we face in life. What results is almost miraculous. We create new alternatives, something that wasn't there before. Synergy is the essence of principle-centered leadership. It is the essence of principle-centered parenting. It catalyzes, unifies, and unleashes the greatest powers within people. All the habits we have covered prepared us to create the miracle of synergy. What is synergy? Simply defined, it means that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. It means that the relationship which the parts have to each other is a part in and of itself. It is not only a part, but the most catalytic, the most empowering, the most unifying, and the most exciting part. The creative process is also the most terrifying part because you don't know exactly what's going to happen or where it is going to lead. You don't know what new dangers and challenges you'll find. It takes an enormous amount of internal security to begin. With the spirit of adventure, the spirit of discovery, the spirit of creativity. Without doubt, you have to leave the comfort zone of base camp and confront an entirely new and unknown wilderness. You become a trailblazer, a pathfinder. You open new possibilities, new territories, new continents so that others can follow. Synergy is everywhere in nature. If you plant two plants close together, the roots commingle and improve the quality of the soil so that both plants will grow better than if they were separated. If you put two pieces of wood together, they will hold much more than the total of the weight held by each separately. The whole is greater than the sum of its parts. 1 + 1 = 3 or more. The challenge is to apply the principles of creative cooperation, which we learn from nature, in our social interactions. Family life provides many opportunities to observe synergy and to practice it. The very way that a man and a woman bring a child into the world is synergistic. The essence of synergy is to value differences, to respect them, to build on strength, to compensate for weaknesses. We obviously value the physical differences between men and women, husbands and wives. But what about the social, mental, and emotional differences? Could these differences not also be sources of creating new exciting forms of life, creating an environment that is truly fulfilling for each person, that nurtures the self-worth and self-esteem and self-worth of each, that creates opportunities for each to mature into independence and then gradually into interdependence? Could synergy not create a new script for the new generation? One that is more geared to service and contribution, and is less protective, less adversarial, less selfish. One that is more open, more trusting, more giving, and is less defensive, protective, and political. one that is more loving, more caring, and is less possessive and judgmental. Synergistic communication. When you communicate synergistically, you are simply opening your mind and heart and expressions to new possibilities, new alternatives, new options. It may seem as if you are casting aside habit too, to begin with the end in mind. But in fact, you're doing the opposite. You're fulfilling it. You're not sure when you engage in synergistic communication how things will work out or what the end will look like. But you do have an inward sense of excitement and security and adventure, believing that it will be significantly better than it was before, and that is the end that you have in mind. You begin with the belief that parties involved will gain more insight, and that the excitement of that mutual learning and insight will create a momentum toward more and more insights, learnings, and growth. Many people have not really experienced even a moderate degree of synergy in their family life or in other interactions. They've been trained and scripted into defensive and protective communications or into believing that life or other people can't be trusted. As a result, they are never really open to habit 6 and to these principles. This represents one of the great tragedies and wastes in life, because so much potential remains untapped, completely underdeveloped and unused. Ineffective people live day and after day with unused potential. They experience synergy only in small peripheral ways in their lives. They may have memories of some unusual creative experiences, perhaps in athletics, where they were involved in a real team spirit for a period of time. Or perhaps they were in an emergency situation where people cooperated to an unusually high degree and submerged ego and pride in an effort to save someone's life or to produce a solution to a crisis. To many, such events may seem unusual, almost out of character with life, even miraculous. But this is not so. These things can be produced regularly, consistently, almost daily in people's lives, but it requires enormous personal security and openness and a spirit of adventure. Most all creative endeavors are somewhat unpredictable. They often seem ambiguous, hit or miss, trial and error. And unless people have a high tolerance for ambiguity and get their security from integrity to principles and inner values, they find it unnerving and unpleasant to be involved in highly creative enterprises. Their need for structure, certainty, and predictability is too high. Synergy in the classroom. As a teacher, I have come to believe that many truly great classes teeter on the very edge of chaos. Synergy tests, whether teachers and students are really open to the principle of the whole being greater than the sum of its parts. There are times when neither the teacher nor the student knows for sure what's going to happen. In the beginning, there's a safe environment that enables people to be really open and to learn and to listen to each other's ideas. Then comes brainstorming, where the spirit of evaluation is subordinated to the spirit of creativity, imagining, and intellectual networking. Then, an absolutely unusual phenomenon begins to take place. The entire class is transformed with the excitement of a new thrust, a new idea, a new direction that's hard to define. Yet, it's almost palpable to the people involved. Synergy is almost as if a group collectively agrees to subordinate old scripts and to write a new one. I'll never forget a university class I taught in leadership, philosophy, and style. We were about 3 weeks into a semester when, in the middle of a presentation, one person started to relate some very powerful personal experiences, which were both emotional and insightful. A spirit of humility and reverence fell upon the class, reverence toward this individual and appreciation for his courage. This spirit became fertile soil for a synergistic and creative endeavor. Others began to pick up on it, sharing some of their experiences and insights and even some of their self-doubts. The spirit of trust and safety prompted many to become extremely open. Rather than present what they prepared, they fed on each other's insights and ideas and started to create a whole new scenario as to what that class could mean. I was deeply involved in the process. In fact, I was almost mesmerized by it because it seemed so magical and creative, and I found myself gradually loosening up my commitment to the structure of the class and sensing entirely new possibilities. It wasn't just a flight of fancy. There was a sense of maturity and stability and substance which transcended by far the old structure and plan. We abandoned the old syllabus, the purchased textbooks, and all the presentation plans, and we set up new purposes and projects and assignments. We became so excited about what was happening that in about 3 more weeks, we all sensed an overwhelming desire to share what was happening with others. We decided to write a book containing our learnings and insights on the subject of our study, Principles of Leadership. Assignments were changed, new projects were undertaken, new teams formed. People worked much harder than they ever would have in the original class structure and for an entirely different set of reasons. Out of this experience emerged a unique, extremely cohesive and synergistic culture that did not end with the semester. For years, alumni meetings were held among members of that class. Even today, many years later, when we see each other, we talk about it and often attempt to describe what happened and why. One of the interesting things to me was how little time had elapsed before there was sufficient trust to create such synergy. I think it was largely because the people were relatively mature. They were in the final semester of their senior year, and I think they wanted more than just another good classroom experience. They were hungry for something new and exciting, something that they could create that was truly meaningful. It was an idea whose time had come for them. In addition, the chemistry was right. I felt that experiencing synergy was more powerful than talking about it, that producing something new was more meaningful than simply reading something old. I've also experienced, as I believe most people have, times that were almost synergistic, times that hung on the edge of chaos for some reason descended into it. Sadly, people who are burned by such experiences often begin their next new experience with that failure in mind. They defend themselves against it and cut themselves off from synergy. It's like administrators who set up new rules and regulations based on the abuses of a few people inside an organization, thus limiting the freedom and creative possibilities for many, or business partners who imagine the worst scenarios possible and write them up in legal language, killing the whole spirit of creativity, enterprise, and synergistic possibility. As I think back on many consulting and executive education experiences, I can say that the highlights were almost always synergistic. There was usually an early moment that required considerable courage, perhaps in becoming extremely authentic, in confronting some inside truth about the individual or the organization or the family, which really needed to be said, but took a combination of considerable courage and genuine love to say. Then others became more authentic, open and honest, and the synergistic communication process began. It usually became more and more creative and ended up in insights and plans that no one had anticipated initially. As Carl Rogers thought, That which is most personal is most general. The more authentic you become, the more genuine in your expression, particularly regarding personal experiences and even self-doubts, the more people can relate to your expression and the safer it makes them feel to express themselves. That expression in turn feeds back on the other person's spirit and genuine creative empathy takes place, producing new insights and learnings and a sense of excitement and adventure that keeps the process going. People then begin to interact with each other almost in half sentences, sometimes incoherent, but they get each other's meanings very rapidly. Then whole new worlds of insight, new perspectives, new paradigms that ensures options, new alternatives are opened up and thought about. Though occasionally these new ideas are left up in the air, they usually come to some kind of closure that is practical and useful. Synergy in business. I enjoyed one particularly meaningful synergistic experience as I worked with my associates to create the corporate mission statement for our business. Almost all members of the company went high up into the mountains, were surrounded by the magnificence of nature. We began with the first draft of what some of us considered to be an excellent mission statement. At first, the communication was respectful, careful, and predictable. But as we began to talk about the various alternatives, possibilities, and opportunities ahead, people became very open and authentic and simply started to think out loud. The mission statement agenda gave way to a collective free association, a spontaneous piggybacking of ideas. People were genuinely empathic as well as courageous, and we moved from mutual respect and understanding to creative synergistic communication. Everyone could sense it. It was exciting. As it matured, we returned to the task of putting the evolved collective vision into words, each of which contains specific and committed to meaning for each participant. The resulting corporate mission statement reads, "Our mission is to empower people and organizations to significantly increase their performance capability in order to achieve worthwhile purposes through understanding and living principle-centered leadership." The synergistic process that led to the creation of our mission statement engraved it in the hearts and minds of everyone there, and it has served as well as a frame of reference of what we are about, as well as what we are not about. Another high-level synergy experience took place when I accepted an invitation to serve as the resource and discussion catalyst at the annual planning meeting of a large insurance company. Several months ahead, I met with a committee responsible to prepare for and stage the two-day meeting, which was to involve all the top executives. They informed me that the traditional pattern was to identify four or five major issues through questionnaires and interviews and to have alternative proposals presented by the executives. Past meetings had been generally respectful exchanges, occasionally deteriorating into defensive win-lose ego battles. They were usually predictable, uncreative, and boring. As I talked with the committee members about the power of synergy, they could sense its potential. With considerable trepidation, they agreed to change the pattern. They requested various executives to prepare anonymous white papers on each of the high-priority issues and then asked all the executives to immerse themselves in these papers ahead of time in order to understand the issues and the different points of view. They were to come to the meeting prepared to listen rather than to present, prepared to create and synergize rather than to defend and protect. We spent the first half day in the meeting teaching the principles and practicing the skills of habits 4, 5, and 6. The rest of the time was spent in creative synergy. The release of creative energy was incredible. excitement replaced boredom, people became very open to each other's influence and generated new insights and options. By the end of the meeting, an entirely new understanding of the nature of the central company challenge evolved. The white paper proposals became obsolete. Differences were valued and transcended. A new common vision began to form. Once people have experienced real synergy, they are never quite the same again. They know the possibility of having other such mind-expanding adventures in the future. Often, attempts are made to recreate a particular synergistic experience, but this seldom can be done. However, the essential purpose behind creative work can be recaptured. Like the far Eastern philosophy, we seek not to imitate the masters. Rather, we seek what they sought. We seek not to imitate past creative synergistic experiences. Rather, we seek new ones around new and different and sometimes higher purposes. Synergy and communication. Synergy is exciting. Creativity is exciting. It's phenomenal what openness and communication can produce. The possibilities of truly significant gain, of significant improvement, are so real that it's worth the risk such openness entails. After World War II, the United States commissioned David Lilienthal to head the new Atomic Energy Commission. Lilienthal brought together a group of people who were highly influential, celebrities in their own right, disciples, as it were, of their own frames of reference. This very diverse group of individuals had an extremely heavy agenda, and they were impatient to get at it. In addition, the press was pushing them. But Lilienthal took several weeks to create a high emotional bank account. He had these people get to know each other, their interests, their hopes, their goals, their concerns, their backgrounds, their frames of reference, their paradigms. He facilitated the kind of human interaction that creates a great bonding between people, and he was heavily criticized for taking the time to do it because it wasn't efficient. But the next result was that this group became closely knit together, very open with each other, very creative and synergistic. The respect among the members of the commission was so high that if there was a disagreement, instead of opposition and defense, there was a genuine effort to understand. The attitude was, if a person of your intelligence and competence and commitment disagrees with me, then there must be something to your disagreement that I don't understand, and I need to understand it. You have a perspective, a frame of reference I need to look at. Non-protective interaction developed and an unusual culture was born. The following diagram illustrates how closely trust is related to different levels of communication. The lowest level of communication coming out of low trust situations would be characterized by defensiveness, protectiveness, and often legalistic language, which covers all the bases and spells out qualifiers and the escape clauses in the event things go south or go sour. Such communication produces only win-lose or lose-lose. It isn't effective. There's no PPC balance, and it creates further reasons to defend and protect. The middle position is respectful communication. This is the level where fairly mature people interact. They have respect for each other, but they want to avoid the possibility of ugly confrontations, so they communicate politely but not empathically. They might understand each other intellectually, but they really don't deeply look at the paradigms and assumptions underlying their own positions and become open to new possibilities. Respectful communication works in independent situations and even in interdependent situations. but the creative possibilities are not opened up. In interdependent situations, compromise is the position usually taken. Compromise means that 1 + 1 = 1.5. Both give and take. The communication isn't defensive or protective or angry or manipulative. It is honest and genuine and respectful, but it isn't creative or synergistic. It produces a low form of win-win. Synergy means that 1 + 1 may equal 8, 16, or even 1,600. The synergistic position of high trust produces solutions better than any originally proposed, and all parties know it. Furthermore, they genuinely enjoy the creative enterprise. A mini culture is formed to satisfy in and of itself. Even if it is short-lived, the PPC balance is there. There are some circumstances in which synergy may not be achievable and no deal isn't viable. But even in these circumstances, the spirit of sincere trying will usually result in a more effective compromise. Fishing for the third alternative. To get a better idea of how our level of communication affects our interdependent effectiveness, envision the following scenario. It's vacation time, and a husband wants to take his family out to the lake country to enjoy camping and fishing. This is important to him. He's been planning it all year. He's made reservations at a cottage on the lake and arranged to rent a boat, and his sons are really excited about going. His wife, however, wants to use the vacation time to visit her ailing mother some 250 miles away. She doesn't have the opportunity to see her very often, and this is important to her. Their differences could be the cause of a major negative experience. The plans are set. The boys are excited. We should go on the fishing trip, he says. But we don't know how much longer my mother will be around, and I want to be by her, she replies. This is our only opportunity to have enough time to do that. All year long, we've looked forward to this one-week vacation. The boys would be miserable sitting around grandmother's house for a week. They drive everybody crazy. Besides, your mother's not that sick, and she has her sister less than a mile away to take care of her. She's my mother, too. I want to be with her. You could phone her every night, and we're planning to spend time with her at the Christmas family reunion, remember? That's not for 5 more months. We don't even know if she'll still be here by then. Besides, she needs me and she wants me. She's being well taken care of. Besides, the boys and I need you too. My mother is more important than fishing. Your husband and sons are more important than your mother? As they disagree back and forth, they finally come up with some kind of compromise. They may decide to split up. He takes the boys fishing at the lake while she visits her mother, and they both feel guilty and unhappy. The boys sense it, and it affects their enjoyment of the vacation. The husband may give in to his wife, but he does it grudgingly, and consciously or unconsciously, he produces evidence to fulfill his prophecy of how miserable the week will be for everyone. The wife may give in to her husband, but she's withdrawn and overreactive to any new developments in her mother's health situation. If her mother were to become seriously ill and die, the husband could never forgive himself, and she couldn't forgive him either. Whatever compromise they finally agree on, it could be rehearsed over the years as evidence of insensitivity, neglect, or a bad priority decision on either part. It could be a source of contention for years and could even polarize the family. Many marriages that once were beautiful and soft and spontaneous and loving have deteriorated to the level of hostility through a series of incidents just like this. The husband and wife see the situation differently, and that difference can polarize them, separate them, create wedges in the relationship, or it can bring them closer together on a higher level. If they have cultivated the habits of effective interdependence, they approach their differences from an entirely different paradigm. Their communication is on a higher level. Because they have a high emotional bank account, they have trust and open communication in their marriage. Because they think win-win, they believe in a third alternative, a solution that is mutually beneficial and is better than what either of them originally proposed. Because they listen empathically and seek first to understand, they create within themselves and between them a comprehensive picture of the values and the concerns that need to be taken into account in making a decision. And the combination of those ingredients, the high emotional bank account, thinking win-win, and seeking first to understand, creates the ideal environment for synergy. Buddhism calls this the middle way. Middle in this sense does not mean compromise. It means higher, like the apex of the triangle. In searching for the middle or higher way, this husband and wife realize that their love, their relationship is part of their synergy. As they communicate, the husband really deeply feels his wife's desire, her need to be with her mother, understands how she wants to relieve her sister, who has had the primary responsibility for their mother's care, understands that they really don't know how long she will be with them, and that she certainly is more important than fishing. And the wife deeply understands her husband's desire to have the family together and to provide a great experience for the boys. She realizes the investment that has been made in lessons and equipment to prepare for this fishing vacation, and she feels the importance of creating good memories with them. So they pull those desires, and they're not on opposite sides of the problem. They're together on one side, looking at the problem, understanding the needs, and working to create a third alternative that will meet them. Maybe we could arrange another time within the month for you to visit with your mother, he suggests. I could take over the home responsibilities for the weekend and arrange for some help at the first of the week so that you could go. I know it's important to you to have that time. Or maybe we could locate a place to camp and fish that would be close to your mother. The area wouldn't be as nice, but we could still be outdoors and meet other needs as well. And the boys wouldn't be climbing the walls. We could even plan some recreational activities with the cousins, aunts, and uncles, which would be an added benefit. They synergize. They communicate back and forth until they come up with a solution they both feel good about. It's better than the solutions either of them originally proposed. It's better than compromise. It's synergistic. Solution that builds P and PC. Instead of a transaction, it's a transformation. They get what they both really want and build their relationship in the process.